Well, hey, why don't we do this? Why don't we, since we're just, our hearts are ready to get into God's Word, why don't we just jump right into God's Word and hear what God wants to speak to each and every one of us today? Can we do that this morning? Let's just go before the Lord. Let's just keep our hearts open and prepared to hear from God. And let's go before the Lord in prayer today. Amen. Father, we thank you for the opportunity that we have to be here in your house, God. We ask that you would speak to us, each and every one of us, right where we're at, as we look into your word, as we look into your will, as we look into your desire for us. Father, we thank you that you would just minister each and every one of us today as we look to you as the author and finisher of our faith. Lord, we give you the praise and the glory and the honor for all that you'd accomplish in our hearts. And today, in Jesus' mighty name, and Lord, we thank you, God, because there are a lot of great churches and pastors in the city of Atlanta. So God, we ask for a special anointing over Atlanta this morning. Because New England, Lord, we thank you for the pastors and churches of Atlanta. We ask that their prayers would availeth much in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If you're a Patriots fan, we have prayer teams afterwards and we can pray for you. I see my man over there in the jersey in the back. Praise God. Hey, babe, was my Bible over there? Wow, they brought my Bible out. Oh, praise God. You know, I think of that story back today. If you'd open your book to the, open your Bibles to the book of Genesis, we're going to talk about Abraham contending for the people of Sodom and Gomorrah. And he prayed for, you know, 50 righteous people. And God said, I forgive it. And he said, for 10 righteous people. And I believe that Atlanta is that story, that there are 10 righteous people in the city of Atlanta. Therefore, God's presence and his favor is upon. No, I'm just teasing. That's not where we're going today. But if you could guess, yes, today is the Super Bowl, and no, I don't like the Patriots. I see my sister-in-law. I do it because of you, really. She's a Patriots fan, and they're just the team that everybody loves to hate. It's because they cheat, but it's okay. I mean, it's all right. If you video record everybody else's practices and deflate footballs, you'll win too. But anyways, I'm just kidding. Tom Brady's an amazing guy, and we pray for him daily. Praise God. If you got your Bibles, go to the book of Hebrews. We'll get spiritual and talk about theological deep things today. So we set our hearts on the minds and the things of God. Go to the book of Hebrews chapter 12. We've been going line upon line, precept upon precept. All the Patriots fans are done. They're like, I'm not listening to you. You got nothing I want to hear. Thank God you didn't come to hear from me then. Amen. Came to hear from Jesus, from his Holy Spirit. Patriots. Hebrews chapter 12. True patriots of God, Hebrews chapter 12. We've been going line upon line, precept upon precept, and we've been in this amazing series in the past couple of weeks with Pastor Dan called Bitter or Blessed, and today I want to take you to some scriptures in the next portion of the section of scriptures in Hebrews chapter 12, kind of a complex group of scriptures, and we'll look at them today, and we're going to kind of look at overview of them, but before we get into the scriptures today, I want to just take you back to a moment that I had in my life and just kind of share that with you, and I think that maybe you can relate to that as we look at what God wants to speak out of the chapters today and out of the verses today. I remember when I was about 5 or 6 years old, my grandparents, they lived in Palm Desert. My father's mother and father. We used to call my grandpa Bubba, and we call my grandma Nana. And so Bubba and Nana, they lived in Palm Springs or Palm Desert. And out there in Palm Desert, you know, when it's like 145 degrees, the only thing that you can do is like go immerse yourself in water because it's just so hot, nothing else works. And so my grandpa had this pool. He was a contractor and he built this pool, and it was this really cool pool. I remember, you know, when you're that old, you don't have a lot of vivid memories, but I remember his pool. I remember that it had this really cool shaped pool, and he had this big rock waterfall on one end of it. And, you know, it'd be so hot in the daytime, you couldn't swim, and you'd have to wait until the sun would start to go down to go out and go swimming. And I remember that as a 5-year-old, 6 years old, I remember that we would go swimming, and you know, they didn't have pool noodles in those days and all the different things. If you didn't know how to swim, you remember they put those little inflatable floaties on your arms and you try to not keep your face down in the water because that's kind of what they do. And I remember as a kid, everybody would be swimming and I didn't know how to swim yet. So, you know, I'd hold on to the coping. You ever seen kids do that? And you just kind of like shuffle across the pool and you'd say, like, I made it all the way. And look, I'm in the deep end. And you're holding on to the coping and you'd kind of go through. And I remember my grandpa, he was just a real man's man, you know, just kind of wanted to just you know, push it to the next limit. And I remember one day my grandpa wanted to help us swim and help me, you know, inspire me to swim. And I think it was my grandpa who did it. It's not so clear, but my grandpa, he picked me up and he threw me into the pool, into the spot where I couldn't touch the ground. I remember this, that I remember my sister Jessica, she was there just in case, and you know, hoping that, you know, the phrase sink or swim. Hoping that I would, you know, it was like instantly snap into that, like, you know, that idea of like, oh, I know how to swim all of a sudden and start swimming. Well, I didn't know how to swim and I didn't learn how to swim. As a matter of fact, I had to go take swimming lessons and breaking free to get over my fear of water. I remember my sister helped me over to the coping, and once again, I kind of worked my way back to what I knew in the comfort zone of the coping in my life. You know, I was thinking about it. I think life is sometimes a lot like that. I think as we look at life, as we look at how we go through this journey of life, as we kind of go step by step and process through process, and we don't know what the next day holds, and we don't know what goes on, and you know, we kind of want to stay in the areas of where our feet can touch the ground, or we have solid coping to hold on to. And we say, as I'm going to go through life, I kind of want to just shuffle my way through, and you know, I look over at the deep end, and I can say, like, I'm holding on to the coping in the deep end. But if you know anything, and I know anything about life, life has a way of doing exactly what my grandfather did. And that's by throwing us into the deep end to the point where you're trying to keep your head above water. You're gasping for air. There's fear and this terror of, I don't know if I'm going to survive. I don't know if I'm going to make it. I don't know how I'm going to get back to the coping. I don't know how I'm going to get back to that place of safety, of security. And life just has that way. I mean, the first time, if any of you parents in this place, the first time you saw your child when they were born, I mean, I remember everybody told me as a dad, oh, your life will never be the same. And I kept wondering, what is that going to mean? What does that mean to me? My life will never be the same. And the first time I saw my boy, Bjorn, I remembered, my life will never be the same. And I got thrust into the deep end of life. And it was like gasping for air. How do I keep this little thing alive? I don't know. You know, you go in the crib at night, or you go in the room at night, and like, are they still breathing? You get tossed into the deep end. You know, maybe you jumped into a relationship, you got married to your sweetheart, you were, you know, it was all rainbows and Valentine's Day's coming up, and it was all hearts and rainbows and unicorns and little cupids and all these different things. And you look at the movies and you say, man, true love, movies like The Notebook, it's gonna be so good. And this love like Romeo and Juliet, it's gonna be, and then all of a sudden you jump in the deep end and you're like, I didn't realize how hard marriage is. And you're swimming in the deep end, and don't look around right now. If that's you right now, if you're going through that, just look straight forward. Amen, somebody else. Maybe it's that career. You jumped into a career, you jumped into school, and you know, all of a sudden it was just like you're the deep end. You're deeper than you thought you could. You thought you could do it. You thought you had the chops. You thought you had the skills to do it. And all of a sudden you realize you didn't know anything about life. You didn't know have any skills. And you're in that deep end financially. So many of us in America jump into the deep end financially. They mail us that little plastic card when we're 18 years old and say, hey, have this on us. And we jump right into the deep end. And now we're gasping for air, hoping to get to the coping in life. Sometimes life in general has that way of just thrusting us into the deep end in which we can't swim and we can't touch the bottom. And we wonder, how on earth are we going to make it? Anybody ever been there before in their lives? You know, the beautiful thing is that you're not alone in that. That you're not by yourselves in those seasons. You're not by yourselves in whatever it might be, whether it be parenting, relational, whether it be professional or financial, whatever it might be, maybe even in your faith. You're kind of wondering, you know, I'm not sure how I can make it through this season of my faith and this challenge of these questions that I'm having and I'm seeking and I'm wondering and I'm asking God. And I'm wrestling right now with some things in my heart. The beautiful thing is that you're not all alone in this matter. See, as a matter of fact, when we look at what the book of Hebrews is, as we've been studying Hebrews line upon line, precept upon precept for several years now, when we look at the very context, the very subject matter of what this book or this letter of Hebrews is a letter that was written to people just like you, just like me. People who were thrust into the deep end of life, that were treading water, barely keeping their head above water, and they were wondering, can I make it? Can I do it? I don't know if I can even do this any longer. And they were beginning to lose hope and beginning to give up and wondering if they should go back to the coping of life. That's what Hebrews is all about. You see, there's so many things in life that bring us to that place of just almost to the place where you feel like you're drowning. And as we look at what Hebrews are, or what the book of Hebrews is, and we read in
Hebrews chapter 11, the hall of faith is examples of encouragement that you can do it. They did it, you can do it. And then we see Hebrews chapter 12 and, you know, running the race and set aside the weights and the things that ensnare us and run that race that's been set before us, looking at Jesus. And then we talked about strengthening the arms and the knees and lifting up those arms to God, and then, you know, living a life of holiness and leaving beside or behind the things that would hold us back with the things of the flesh, and that we wouldn't be profane or that we wouldn't be fornicator, spiritually speaking, that we wouldn't be like Esau who give up our inheritance in God for something so insignificant in life as a bowl of lentil soup. We've talked about that a couple of weeks ago. And today we're going to look at this section of scripture in the next couple of verses in Hebrews, the 12th chapter. And in verse number 18, I want to just take you through some verses. And with that in mind, that this is a group of people who were thrust into the deep end, and they were barely hanging on, considering giving up, considering going back to what they had and what they knew, going back to the coping of life. And their encouragement was here in Hebrews chapter 12. Verse number 18, it says, "For you've not come to the mountain that may be touched and burned with fire and blackness and darkness and tempest, that the sound of a trumpet and the voice of words, so those who heard it begged that the word would not be spoken to them anymore. For they could not endure what was commanded. And if so much of a beast," this is the commandment, "and if so much as a beast touches the mountain, it should be stoned or shot with an arrow. And so terrifying was the sight of this mountain that Moses said, 'I'm exceedingly afraid and trembling.' But you have come," verse number 22, "to Mount Zion, and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to an innumerable company of angels, to a general assembly in the church of the firstborn who are registered in heaven, to God, the judge of all, to the spirits of just men who have been made perfect, to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaks better things than Abel." And if you're like me, you just read through that and you said, "What? It's okay." See, what's happening here is in Hebrews, the 12th chapter, particularly verse number 18 through verse number 24, is imagery speaking. This is the capital piece of the pillar of the book of Hebrews. When you think about a pillar, you think about Washington, D.C., or maybe go back to Greece or Rome and those great Roman Corinthian pillars, and on the top of those pillars, they have those really ornate top pieces that are, you know, they've carved with flowers and all different beautiful imagery on the top of a pillar. That's called a capital. It's the crowning piece of that pillar that supports the load of that building. Hebrews chapter 12, particularly towards the end, Hebrews chapter 12, this is the capital piece of the pillar of the book of Hebrews, the encouragement to the church. Speaking to them, saying, "Hey, listen, I understand you're going through life. I understand that you're drowning in the pressures of life and you don't know how you're going to make it. You're wondering if you're going to survive this time and this season in life. You've been going through persecutions. They've been taking your things and you've been suffering greatly in life." But then he brings us to this comparison. And in these six verses, there's so much truth and there's so much depth and there's so much understanding that when we read through it, like we read through it, we kind of look at it and we say, "What are they talking about?" And it's a comparison of two physical mountains that we read about in the Bible, in the Old Testament. Verse number 18 through verse number 21 talks about this mountain we call Sinai. Maybe you've heard in the Bible, maybe you heard at one point in your life the story of a man by the name of Moses. Moses was this great man who led the Israelites out of Egypt, and he came to this mountain called Sinai. And there the presence of God fell on the mountain of Sinai. And God told the people, "I'm going to come. You need to consecrate yourselves. You need to cleanse yourselves because I'm coming. And I'm going to fall upon this mountain in a shroud of glory and a cloud of darkness and fire and thunder. And his voice spoke out and the trumpets of heaven blew. And they were not a glorious celebratory sound. It was a fearful and a dreadful sound. And Moses there ascended this mountain." You might know the story. "And he came down with two tablets of stone." You know what I'm talking about? "And they had 10 commandments on them." Anybody ever heard of 10 commandments? Yes. Don't worry, I'm not going to quiz you and ask you what the 10 commandments are. But this is what they're talking about, is this story of the presence of God descending upon a mountain. was a fearful time. It was the adolescence of the people of God, and it was like a parent. Maybe, you know, like with your firstborn, you kind of, you might grill them a little bit harder, hoping that the subsequent children would know that they're not going to get away with anything in the house. And this is kind of that illustration of the presence of God coming down so that the generations would realize and recognize that God is not a joke. God is not just something cuddly and beautiful that we get to hug on, and it's all hearts and rainbows and all love and kisses and all these good things. This was a time of fear and trembling. And then he contrasts it with this mountain called Zion. Zion is a mountain in which Jerusalem is built upon. Mount Moriah, Mount Zion, they're standing next to each other. Jerusalem is built upon that, the temple of God, the presence of God there dwelt and resided there on Zion. Zion is a place in which people would make a pilgrimage throughout the land of Israel several times a year to honor God, to celebrate God, to glorify God, to make repentance or penance for their sins. Zion was a place in which people would pilgrimage to. And Zion is also a representation of the presence and of the Spirit of God. And so here, the author of Hebrews creates this contrast between this dark and this gloomy place. And he gives us seven illustrations of what it is. And then he creates this contrast of this celebratory, glorifying place called Zion. And he gives us seven beautiful illustrations of what that is. And so there's this compare and this contrast between Sinai and Zion. And as I was looking at this, and I was looking at what God wants to speak today in my heart, in your heart, as we live this life and we don't know what tomorrow holds. And so often in seasons, as we relocate in life, as we venture into new areas and new arenas, as we try to deal with the realities of parenting, as we look at where we're at as a political nation right now and the tensions within our own nation racially and politically, we're in the deep end of life. And what does God want to speak to his people? What does God want to say out of these verses that when we read through them, we kind of scratch our head and say, God, I don't quite get what you're saying here. And so I want to just simply boil it down to the simplicity in these six verses, I believe, overall, the general message of what God wants to say to you in the seasons of your life in which you live like the Hebrews. To me, in the seasons of my life in which I feel like I might be drowning or I might jump in over my head and I don't know how I'm going to make it to today. I don't know how I'm going to make it through tomorrow. I don't know how I'm going to get through this season. It doesn't look like everything's working out. I'm just uncertain and unsure of life as it is. What does God want to say? And I want to take a look at these two verses. Verse number 18, verse number 22. Verse number 18 says this to you and I. To the readers thousands of years later, as we read this letter of Hebrews, it says, you have not come to a mountain that which may be touched. You've not come to a physical place, a place that is burned with fire, and the blackness of darkness and the tempest is upon it. This imagery of this trial, this place of fear, this place of dread, this place of anguish, this place of trembling. He says, this is not in your life where you've come. But then verse number 22 comes and brings the comparison, and it says this, that it says, but you have come to Zion, to a heavenly place, to a place in which the glory of God shines, not the darkness of life, but the glory of God. And so there's this comparison in life. And so often life to you and I, it seems as though we are at Sinai, that we're in this tempest period, this darkness, this fear, this trembling, this uncertainty, this as the voice of God speaks, we fall on our face and say, speak no more, I can't handle it, I can't do it, I can't make it. And the reminder to you and I is that even though it might appear in your life as though you are at Sinai, and this is what the Hebrews were feeling, that's not where you've come. See, where you've come is to Zion. The heavenly place, the place of the glory of God, the place of the pleasure of God, the place of the blessings of God, the place in which God shines upon you. You've come to the place of Jesus Christ, to the things better of old, to the place where God wants to lift you up and not bring you down. This is where you have come. And as we look at this, we need to remember and we need to see in our lives that with Jesus Christ, there is hope in where we are headed in life. There is hope in where you're headed. It might appear as though you're at Sinai in your life. that you're wondering, what's going on? The earth is shaking below me. There's a tempest. Does a mount burn with fire in my life? My life right now, emotionally, spiritually, mentally, physically, financially, feels like scorched earth. But with Jesus Christ, there is hope to where you're headed. There is hope to where you're headed. That it might seem, that it might appear that you've been launched, that you've been pushed, that you've been tossed into the deep end of life. But with Jesus Christ, that is not where you have come to. Rather, you have come to the Mount of Sinai, the Mount of God, the summit of the experience of the glory of God, that God wants to do something great. God wants to do something wonderful. God wants to take you through the place of tempest, the place of fire, the place of fear, to a place of faith, to a place of faith, to a place of glory, to a place of rejoicing in the presence of God with Jesus. Church, there is hope where you're headed. And sometimes when we're holding on to life by just a thread, by just a glimmer of hope, that's all we need to endure the moment, to endure the tempest, to endure the storm, to camp at the base of Sinai, is to understand that this might be the season of life that I'm in, but this is not the direction, this is not the destination that God has called me to reside in, that where I'm going, I've got hope, because where I am is not where I'll stay, but where I'm going, where God has brought me to, where God has called me out of, there is a hope in my life that I will make it, that I can do this, that I can endure, and I can see the glory and the goodness of God and His revelation in my life. There is hope where you're headed in Jesus Christ. If you've got your Bibles, go with me. I'm going to take you to a couple of Psalms and then we'll be done for this morning. Go with me to the book of Psalms 123. Psalms 123, we're going to look at Psalms 123. We're going to look at a couple of the Psalms right here in the Psalms of Ascent. These are called the Psalms of Ascent. If you have a Bible, you'll see that Psalms 120 all the way through 134 are called Psalms of Ascent, in which Jerusalem is situated at 2,500 feet above sea level. Most of Israel is either at or below. So as people would make their pilgrimage to Zion, as they'd make their pilgrimage to this place of Jerusalem, as they would climb this mountain, so to say, that they would repeat these psalms, they would say these psalms, either the psalms of representation, that as they would make this journey. Maybe you've heard of the valley of the shadow of death. The valley of the shadow of death is en route to Zion. So as they would pass through these places, as they would make their pilgrimage roads, they would say and they would recite and they would sing these psalms over themselves. In Psalms 123, it says that unto you I lift my eyes. O you who dwell in the heavens, behold, as the eyes of servants look to the hand of their master, what would you want me to do next? What do you have for me next in my life? As the eyes of a maid to the hand of her mistress, how can I help you? How can I serve you? What is it that I can do for you? So our eyes look to the Lord our God until He has mercy on us. You see, the Psalms of Ascent are talking about life. And where are we going to fix our focus? As you're making this journey, as you're making this pilgrimage from the place in which you came from, the Sinai of life, the scorched earth, the mountain of fear and trembling, the deep end. And as you make your way to where God has called you, to the Zion, to the summit, to the hill of the Lord Most High, as you fix your eyes upon God, I believe that each and every one of us has a choice in our lives. And why did I not call this message something like where you're going or hope where you're headed or whatever it might be? Why did I decide to keep this message bitter or blessed? Because I believe that as we look at the heart of what Hebrews is saying, as we look at what God is encouraging His church, each and every one of us have a choice in life to make. Will I choose to fix my eyes on the Sinai of my life? Will I choose to focus on the tempest and the darkness that falls upon the mountain in which I might be camped at? Or will I, like the Psalms of Ascent, choose to fix my eyes on the mountain of God, on the summit of Zion? Will I choose to say that while I don't understand what's happening, while it doesn't make any sense, while I feel like I'm being ripped apart in my life, while I feel like I'm gasping for air in the deep end, I won't fix my eyes on that situation, but I'll look to the Zion in which God has called me to. I'll look to the place in which God says, this is where you're destined to be. I'll fix my eyes on God. I'll fix my eyes. Like the psalmist says, I will look to the hills. From where does my help come from? You have a choice in life. Will you live bitter, staring at the Sinai of your life, or will you live blessed, looking at the Zion in which God will call you to? And of course, God doesn't want his people looking at Sinai. He wants his people looking at Zion. You see, even the children of Israel in the wilderness didn't stay at Sinai. It was a moment in time in which the presence of God dwelt upon that mountain, but God's presence led them not to, but away from the mountain to the land in which he promised them. No, you might seem and appear as though you're in that Sinai. You're not there. You see, Sinai, they were only allowed to stay at the base of the mountain. Nothing could touch the mountain. If anything touched the mountain because the presence of God was there, it must be killed. But Zion is not a base. Zion is a summit. God says, do you want to fix your eyes at the base of a mountain? Or do you want to live your life at the summit of the mountain in which God has called you? Your choice. Your choice. How do we do that? You know, I think of life and I think in the physical. I think in the actual. You know, in my own physical, actual life, I've stood on the summit of a great deal of mountains. I've stood on the top of a lot of mountains. I see my brother-in-law Stephen over there, and him and I have had some great adventures. Man, I've told him some funny stories about you and I and shortcuts on Sanji. But we've been on some summits of some pretty big mountains. You know, one of the things I think about in life is I think about the story of the summit of Mount San Gorgonio. As you walk out of this place and as you head eastward, the summit of San Gorgonio is in view from right where we're at today. San Gorgonio is the tallest mountain in Southern California, 11,494 feet. Or depending on who else you talk to, 11,500 feet. They don't quite know. But I think about the times that I've climbed that mountain, the times that I've hiked that mountain. It's like 9.1 miles to the summit, 9.1 miles back. I think about the stories and the times in which I've done that before, and I've done it several times. You start out excited. You start out, you got the permit in hand to go out into the wilderness, and I'm going to get to that mountain. I can't wait to get there. And you drive, and you get to the trailhead, and there's a thing, San Gorgonio Summit, 9 miles away, and you take a picture with it, and you're in the wilderness, and man, I'm so excited to get to that place. And then all of a sudden, the trail starts heading up. And up, and up, and up. And for about 8.5 miles of the 9 mile trail, you don't see the summit of San Gorgonio. You can't even see it. You're in the valleys, you're in the backside, you're in the shadows of other mountains. And about halfway through, you get to the south-facing exposed slopes of San Gorgonio and the mountain San Bernardino's and chaparral, and it's dry, and there's no forest, and it's all charcoaly and just ugh. There's no lakes, there's no rivers, there's no water. And you start to ask yourself, why did I do this? What did I even set out to do this for? I don't feel like I can make it. My legs hurt. I'm tired. I'm thirsty. I'm exhausted. I don't see where I'm going. If I just turn around right now, it's all downhill from here. And I might as well just do that. And what you have to do is you just have to put your head down. And you have to take one step. And you have to take another step. And you have to take another step. And you have to take another step after that. And you have to take another step after that. And you take another step. And although you don't see the destination, and although every step is hard, and although you might take a lot of steps, and then you look back and you say, I've only gone 10 feet. You put one foot in front of the other, and you keep going, and you keep going, and you keep going. But there's this one section on the trail that you just passed the tree line. All the trees are gone, and you come around the corner of the trail, and all of a sudden, after 8.5 miles of grueling uphill exposure to the sun, all of a sudden, the summit of San Gregorio comes into picture, and something happens. Your body begins to realize and to recognize why you set out on that grueling journey to begin with, and adrenaline starts pumping through your body. Adrenaline starts going into your legs, starts going into your lungs, and you start walking. All of a sudden, you get a second wind because you realize, now that I've seen it, I can make it. And I think our faith is a lot like that journey. You know, we set out. Man, it's new year. It's January. I'm going to start following Jesus this year. 2017 is going to be the year that I'm a Christian. And you made it to the trailhead on January 2nd or whatever the day was, January 1st. January 7th, you heard Pastor Dan talk about vision. You heard Pastor Dan talk about Esau and beans. And you said, I'm going to do this, but it's an uphill journey. And now here you are, and you're starting to wonder, why did I set out to do this? Why do I subject myself to this? It was a lot easier last year. It was a lot less complicated. When I didn't have to live in faith, I didn't have to worry about the things that I'm worried about. I just had to just exist and survive the moment. Instead of have faith to not just survive, but to thrive, now you begin to wonder and you begin to question what's going on. Can I make it? My encouragement to you is just like the people of Hebrews. Put one foot in front of the next. Put one foot in front of the next. Put one foot in front of the next, in front of the next, in front of the next. Take a step. Take a step. Take a step. You might not see Zion today in your life. You might not see the promises of God. You might be literally walking through the valley of the shadow of death, but you put one foot in front of the next, in front of the next, in front of the next. You keep walking. And there will be a time in your life where you will round, when you will pass through the valley and you will see the Zion that God has called you to. And then it won't be a question of why did I set out to do this? What am I doing this for? You will know God has called me to this place, to this time, and I'm stronger for what I've walked through. And now I know where God has taken me. Why? Because with Jesus, there is hope in where you're headed. So my encouragement to you is simply this. Don't let what you see today hinder you from where you will be someday in Christ. Because you might see Sinai today. You might see tempest and burned and scorched earth today. You might see the valley of the shadow of death today. You might be obscured in your sight from the vision and to the summit of God, to the Zion of where God wants to take you. But don't allow what you see today, or don't allow what you don't see today, to hinder from where you will be someday with Christ. And I say someday, why? Because that someday might be this afternoon. That someday might be tomorrow. That someday might be next week, but that someday might be next year. That someday might be eternity. But you put one foot in front of the next foot, in front of the next foot, and you walk this out. If you got to take a break because you're winded, if you got to sit down because you can't make it, if you fall or you take one step forward and two steps back, get up, wipe the dust off of you. Stop looking at Sinai. Stop looking at the tempest. Stop looking at the scorched earth. Set your eyes on where God wants to take you, because there is hope where you're headed in Jesus Christ. And you can and will make it. Why? Because like the author of Hebrews says, this is not where you've come to. Where you have come to. Come to, past tense, is Zion. You're already there. Pastor Luke, what do you mean I'm already there? Sinai, he says, you've not come to a mountain that which may be touched. Zion, although it's a physical mountain, I know. I was sleeping there a week and 3 days ago, literally, on Mount Zion, in the Mount Zion Hotel. It's a real mountain. But he talks about, you've come to Zion, to a heavenly Jerusalem, to a company not of just people, but a company of innumerable angels, to the firstborn of the saints of God and to the members of the church. Yeah. You see, Zion might be a physical place on earth, but Zion is a spiritual place in which you have already arrived with Jesus Christ. Which means that if we don't let what we see today hinder us from where we'll be in Jesus Christ, we know that even as we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we are already at Zion in our lives and in our hearts. It's a place of our spirit. It's a place of our heart. It's a place in which we already exist today. Somewhere that you can carry every step of the way. How do I make each step on this journey? You make each step knowing that you are already there. You just got to walk your body there. You got to walk your heart there. You got to walk your mind there. You got to walk your faith there. But according to God's purpose, you are already there. Because it's somewhere you carry within your heart. The Psalms of Ascent, Psalm 125. Says it like this: those who put their trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, the physical, which cannot be moved, founded in the bedrock of earth. As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people from this time forth and forever. You see, when you set your eyes on God, when you don't allow the Sinai moment of your life right now, God's presence was there for a moment. But let me tell you something, God's presence doesn't reside there. There's a monastery on Sinai today, but his presence isn't on Sinai. His presence is in the spiritual Zion in which you have been called to today. And when you put your trust in God, you are founded in bedrock like Zion, and the presence of God surrounds you, that as you walk through the valleys of the shadow of death, as you find those tempest moments, as your life seems as though it's scorched earth, as if you've been pushed into the deep end of life, and you wonder as you gasp for air, how will I make this? You know that as you put one step in front of the next, that as the mountains surround Jerusalem and Zion, so the presence of God surrounds you as you take one step in front of the next step, in front of the next step, on your journey to where God has called you to, because there is hope in where you're headed with Jesus Christ. Take that Zion with you wherever you go. And I love what Jesus tells his disciples. It's akin to what Moses tells the people of Israel as they're about to go into the promised land. It's what Joshua reminds them of, what God said to them as they're about to enter into a strategic military campaign. Jesus reiterates this to his disciples at the end of his time here on earth as he ascends to heaven. He gives us what we call the Great Commission. And Jesus says at the end of this Great Commission, he says, "And lo, I will be with you always until the end of the age." God told Moses to tell the people of Israel, "Go, be strong and courageous, for I will never leave you nor forsake you." Joshua tells the people of Israel as they're about to cross the Jordan River and walk into a fight that God picked for them. Joshua says, "Be strong and courageous, for God will never leave us nor forsake us." Church, it might seem as though you're at Sinai in your life, in your relationship, in your finances, with your kids, in your job, in your emotions. It might seem like you're at the base of this mountain, but God, the presence of God in Mount Zion is with you today, because that is where God has brought you to, and there is hope where you're headed in Jesus Christ. Don't give up. Don't give in. You keep walking one step in front of the next step in front of the next, and God will give you an image of that summit in which he has called you to stand on top of. And when you do, the presence of God will be with you forever, always. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word. I thank you for your encouragement. God, I just ask today that as we walk out of this place, there are those of us who are in seasons in which the sun is shining upon our backs. And Father, I thank you for those seasons. Lord, there are those who are seasons in which we're gasping for air in the deep end, trying to figure out how we're even going to survive this moment or this time. And God, I pray today that your word of encouragement would remain in our hearts, that we would remember to put one step in front of the next. God, that we're not called to the Sinai of life, but rather we're called to the glory of Zion and your presence. Lord, I pray that we would learn and remember to carry the presence of the Holy Spirit wherever we go, Lord, with your comfort, with your peace that surpasses understanding, God, that we might put one foot in front of the next each and every day as we make our way, as we make our journey to the summit of Mount Zion in your presence. And we give you the praise and the honor in Jesus' mighty name. Together we all said, amen. Praise God.